Last night, FBI agents in Albany, New York, arrested two men on the basis of warrants issued on a criminal complaint filed in federal court in Albany. Those men have been identified as 34-year-old Yassin Muhyiddin Aref and 49-year-old Muhammad Musharraf Hossein. Aref is the imam of the Masjid As-Salam Mosque in Albany, and Hossein is the founder of that mosque.
The Justice Department wanted to underscore the fact that the case cannot be characterized as a real terror threat. He said the sting involved a plan to assassinate the Pakistani ambassador to the U.S. using a shoulder-fired missile that in fact belonged to the United States and was inert at the time. It was used as a kind of enticement for the two men who were involved in the sting operation.
Let me say a word about what this case is and what it is not. This is not a case connected to the current terrorist threat. This is not a case where the defendants were discovered plotting terrorist violence.
It's been 2.5 years since the FBI arrested two Albany Muslims in connection with a fake terror plot that grabbed national headlines. And on Thursday, those men learned how long they'll spend behind bars. Jamie Caslow reports.
The Muslim community is standing strong and speaking out as two of their members learn their fate. 36-year-old Yassin Aref and 51-year-old Muhammad Hossein were both sentenced Thursday to 15 years in federal prison for their involvement in a fake terror plot set up by the FBI in 2003.
They are not terrorists. They had no criminal record. They had no interest of any violation of laws or so. Simply, they were tricked.
During his sentencing, Aref made a powerful and emotional plea, but Judge McEvoy said some kind of sentence must be imposed.
I sat through this trial, and I listened very carefully to the evidence, and I am convinced after hearing the verdict in this case that a great injustice was done here at this federal court. And we see that the FBI has changed from a law enforcement agency to now a domestic spying agency. And we can't allow this to happen in this country.
The Justice Department has just concluded a news conference in Washington, D.C. involving the overnight raid of a mosque on Central Avenue in Albany.
So I was waiting, I pray, and I was looking the time, and almost 11, 12 o'clock is... And I couldn't hear from him maybe like more than half an hour, and I was worried. It's around 1 o'clock, and I came, I opened the door. I said, salam, you know, how everything? He said, it's okay, I'm tired. Not even 2-3 minutes in the meantime. At least 4-5 Asian people with the big, all this there, they have all the big gun stuff they're carrying, and they are there. I thought maybe they are doing, and he did something high speed in a highway. They look his driving license and let him come home. Or they're gonna let him go. That was only thinking was that time in my mind was working, nothing else. But it's not that was cause, that was reality, was difference. They took him their car. In the meantime, so many police car around. They stopped on my house. Children was asleep, mom was asleep. 6 o'clock when they leave, they say we can able to go home. And I climb in a home. Like when I go inside the house. That day I never forget my children. Like a sky falling overhead. When I saw morning news and they say like Albany two terrorists they had catch, I was shocked. Still I don't get that what kind of terrorists we are. They took Abdul Bar, they took Brother Yassin's, they searched his house, they took my husband all same night that operation they did. And unbelievable. That was really so horrible night.
Sometime in the spring or summer of 2003, FBI Special Agent Tim Cole asked an informant named Malik to go undercover in a sting operation to get evidence against Yasin Aref, an imam at a local Albany, New York mosque. The FBI had been watching Yasin Aref since 2001 and claimed to have information that he supported terrorist groups. The criminal complaint written by Special Agent Tim Cole explains the government's version of events that led up to the sting and describes each significant date that the informant met with either Yasin Aref or Mohammed Hossein, or both. In the document, the government informant is identified as CI-1, designating him as confidential informant number one.
The informant's role in the case became known first through the court filings, you know, that there was a cooperating witness or a confidential informant involved. And I remember working the streets initially along Central Avenue, talking to people in the Muslim community who they all suspected that the informant was someone by the name of Malik. And of course that was a name that had been crafted, had been made up. And so initially we had just that to go on. I was able to then pinpoint who this person was, and then it turned out he had an open active criminal case in the U.S. court system, helping people illegally obtain driver's licenses as a translator. He would go in and take the test for them, and then for a fee, give them a driver's license for a test they couldn't otherwise pass.
Malik was a convicted con man. He had conned Department of Motor Vehicles, he conned the government, he conned immigrants, and he was a superb con man, and the government knew he was a con man.
Malik was caught in a sting. He got a fake driver's license for somebody, and by the way, his guidelines on that are 0 to 6 months. So, the argument that he was facing 20 years was, you know, again, this is a sentencing guidelines case. But it's not a mixed message, because Malik, when confronted, decided he wanted to cooperate, told us about his other criminal involvement. Agent Cole went out and arrested a bunch of other people based on what Malik said about his criminal involvement. And he basically turned himself around. He decided, you know, only because he was caught, no doubt about that, but he decided to walk the straight and narrow. And I think that that sends a straight message to the community.
You'll never hear an instructor of informant handling say anything but don't ever trust an informant. You'll never hear a prosecutor talking to a jury say anything but trust my informant. The shorthand definition for entrapment is that would the crime have been committed were it not for the actions of the government agent, that is the government informant or the undercover agent.
Why legally this is not entrapment?
Well, I would expect in a case like this, any case involving a sting, and I've tried some myself, entrapment is a defense. And so the question the jury has to answer is, was the defendant sort of dragged into the criminal activity to which he was not predisposed by the government essentially overbearing his will?
Supreme Court stated in a case called Jacobson that somebody has to, when somebody responds to a solicitation for illegal activity by the government through usually a confidential informant or somebody that they don't know is the government, if the person readily responds to the request, then that's not entrapment.
It was the first time the Supreme Court had considered an entrapment case that was not based on drugs or one where the behavior in question was recently considered a crime. The court decided exclusively on whether the defendant had a predisposition to commit the crime. Justice Byron White, in his majority opinion, wrote, quote, "Petitioner's ready response to these solicitations cannot be enough to establish beyond reasonable doubt that he was predisposed prior to the government acts intended to create predisposition."
So now it's a case of whether or not the target of your investigation was predisposed to commit this crime. That's a question that has to be actually settled by a jury.
Well, the trial court applied the ready response analysis and said this is a Jacobson analysis. And our argument is that's not the Jacobson analysis, that Jacobson doesn't even apply to this case because it wasn't the type of case that fits into the ready response. It wasn't an initial contact and an acceptance. That didn't happen. It was 4 months of trying to convince somebody to engage in conduct, and then he accepted. And that's not ready response. It doesn't apply.
The plan was to initially approach Muhammad Hossein, a struggling businessman originally from Bangladesh. Cole's instructions to the undercover informant were to offer him money, $5,000. You'll give him $50,000, and he only has to give back $45,000. After Muhammad agreed to accept the loan and pay it back in monthly installments, Muhammad suggested that Yasin Aref, the imam at the Masjid As-Salam Mosque, witness and record the terms of the loan. Over a period of 6 months, these meetings were either audio or video recorded in Muhammad's pizza shop, Yasin's house, a Dunkin' Donuts, or at Malik's businesses. After their arrest on August 4, 2004, an indictment was handed down for money laundering and conspiracy. Muhammad Hossein was charged with 27 counts, and Yasin Aref was charged with 30 counts. Yasin Aref was charged with three additional counts, two counts of making false statements on an immigration form. One was answering none when listing political organizations, which he had been a member of, and a second of denying that he was a member of the IMK, the Islamic Movement in Kurdistan, and one count of denying to the FBI that he personally knew IMK leader Mullah Krekar.
The court documents allege that Hossein agreed to help launder the money that the cooperating witness represented was going to be the proceeds of the sale of a missile. The cooperating witness, the plan they conceived would go, would give Hossein cash, who would then run that money through his businesses in Albany and repay the cooperating witness using business checks.
Describe to me a little bit about these 27 counts and their meanings. I think there's a different groupings of meanings for the 27 counts that he was convicted for.
They all come from Mohammed Musharraf Hossein receiving money, cash money, in the form of a loan, and then repaying the loan to the informant. All his offenses come from that. And that's each time he made a payment, it's considered a separate crime, each of which results in up to 30 years in jail. Every time he wrote a check for $2,000, it's considered a crime.
The term money laundering refers to the activities and financial transactions that are undertaken specifically to hide the true source of the money. In most cases, the money involved is earned from an illegal enterprise, and the goal is to give that money the appearance of coming from a legitimate source.
The federal law requires that Muhammad Hossein intend to conceal the money transaction. He has to hide it, and he did just the opposite of hiding it. When Malik offered to loan him $50,000, Muhammad Hossein said, it's got to be in writing. We have to have a written document. Malik, who's the government agent, says, no written document. Hossein says, yes, I won't go through it unless it's in writing. So he had a written document. The document was signed by both of them, just like a loan would be. And the document said what the terms would be. And it was $50,000, and it had to be paid back in increments. When the payments were made back, they were made in check. Check form, first day of each month, Muhammad Hossein paid back the monthly payment that was then due. On several of the checks, he actually wrote loan. So he didn't hide anything from anybody. He received money that was loaned to him, he paid it back, he had receipts showing each time he made a payment, he had canceled checks, and he had a written agreement for each payment. And the law requires that he intend to conceal that monetary transaction, and he did not do that.
Eight of the charges stated that Muhammad and Yasin believed that there was a plot to attack the Pakistani ambassador in New York City with a surface-to-air missile. The total of eight counts represent one count for conspiracy, plus seven counts, one for each meeting that money changed hands, after the two allegedly knew the missile plot was connected to the loan.
The cooperating witness brought a shoulder-fired missile to a meeting with Mr. Hossein and explained that he imports such things and ships them to New York City to the Mujahid brothers, the implying terrorist operatives.
And an opportunity was provided to these individuals. An opportunity, a test. There was no question it was a test. And these individuals failed that test dramatically. They sought to assist, to aid, and carry about a terrorist event in this country.
At a public forum organized by the Muslim Solidarity Committee at the Schenectady Public Library, Carl Strock, a local journalist, discussed the case.
There is some ambiguity. If you sat through the trial and listened to the evidence, I think you can make the case that these guys were unduly gullible. When you've got somebody, a stranger, coming to you and say, oh, I'm a rich man, I've got lots of money, and I love you like a brother, and, you know, teach me about your religion, and by the way, I'd like to give you $10,000, that, you know, you might be a little bit suspicious. It was kind of out of context. It was unclear what it was all about. He said he was doing business with this Chinese store selling flashlight batteries and whatnot. Then he said, oh, I also do this. And he showed him this missile launcher. I think Mohammed Musharraf Hussein at that point should have said, whoa, you know, let me out of here. He should have called the cops, and he didn't. He is not without blame. I would be prepared to say, I mean, if I were the judge and jury in this case, that he made a serious mistake by not reporting that to the authorities. This guy showed him a missile launcher. You know, it's something they imposed on him. They tricked him into it. It's nothing he did on his own initiative. I think it's outrageous that they did this to him, that they tried to set him up, and that he's convicted of a crime for it. Nevertheless, there is some ambiguity. I mean, this is not absolutely white and black. He gave the guy checks. The guy says, I'll give you $10,000 cash. And later he gives him back a check. What he thought he was doing that for is unclear. I mean, it's pretty, I think it was just nothing more than a loan.
It was during jury deliberations when I realized that the jury could come back any minute and I would not see Mohammed Hussein again if he's convicted. And I asked him to tell me his life story of how he got here. And he did it over the course of an afternoon standing in the federal courthouse, and it was just heart-wrenching. And I remember being struck by how close Mohammed Hussein came to never making it to the United States. He barely got out of Bangladesh, but his dream was always to get here, and he had this thankless job cleaning the ballast in these ships. It's one of the worst jobs on the open sea. You know, how he came here was such a crapshoot, such a long shot, that he would end up not only in the United States, but end up in Albany.
He have so much happiness. It became a part of this country. Y'all is proud of about that.
Mohammed worked very hard and was able to manage his own business, the Little Italy Pizza Shop. He also bought and renovated several properties, which he rented out. Mohammed valued the opportunities offered to him in the United States, which led to an accomplishment he is most proud of, becoming a United States citizen in 1985.
Why would somebody, this logically does not make sense, why would somebody have a family here, have a business, be here for 20 years, and invest all of his money and all of whatever he had in America, and then try to blow up a place? That doesn't make sense to anybody.
He lived in Albany with his wife Fatima, their 6 children, and many relatives. Mohammed was a co-founder of the Masjid As-Salam Mosque and had never been in trouble with the law.
Dear Dad, I miss you really much. You don't call or we don't get to visit you. As soon as you left, I kept on having dreams about you. Mom told me to start eating at the party so you could come back home. I love you, Dad, and I miss you. Even though I write to you, I just say I love you. But I really mean it. P.S. Right back. Sincerely, Khalida Habiba Singh.
After Muhammad agreed to the loan, it was suggested to Muhammad by Malik that there needed to be someone to witness the loan, an honest person. Yasin Aref was suggested, the imam at the Masjid As-Salam Mosque. Yasin's first meeting was December 10, 2003, when Malik explained how the loan would be paid back. Although Aref's English was rusty, as he had only been in the United States since 1999, he was an obvious choice, as it is customary for imams to assist mosque members in many ways. Aref began to attend meetings with Muhammad and Malik, and the January 2, 2004 meeting was the first time that any money was exchanged.
On January 2nd, Yasin appears for the first of these transactions in which he's supposed to witness the loan. And the government agent, Malik, pulls out a wad of bills and hands them to Yasin and says, count this as part of the act of witnessing the transaction so he will know exactly how much money is being transferred. And you see Yasin taking the money and starting to count it. And as he is counting it, the government agent Malik turns to Hussein, who's sitting next to him, and says, this is part of the mizail that I told you about, and pulls out this handle, which looks like a kind of counter that you would put prices on in a supermarket.
The triggering device, I don't know what it was. I mean, you've seen it, you've seen the photographs. It's not recognizable to anyone. You could put that device on a table and ask 100 people what it is, and 99 of them would get it wrong. And so I think that for me was the most troubling part of the case, that they didn't show Yasin the missile. And it was because he would run. The timeline in the case was critical because the evidence showed there was a use of a code word by the informant, the word Chaudhry, which was to mean missile. There was never evidence offered at trial that Yasin Aref in any of the wiretaps was explained what that word means. The only time they alleged he knew what it meant was when the tape fell off or there was a malfunction.
At the February 12, 2004 meeting, Cole stated, as CI-1 was exiting the vehicle, the concealed recording device fell off his body and into his car. CI-1 thus participated in the meeting without a recording device, although the hidden transmitting device remained on his body, and I continued to remotely listen to the conversation during the meeting through the transmitting device.
And the defense tried to seize on that in a months-long investigation, the only time you're saying our guy found out what the deal was is when it wasn't recorded and the agent could hear it. It may very well be true, it's plausible, that it was an accidental malfunction. It was one more thing that called into question the informant's character and integrity. Use of that word from that point forward was in question. Did Yasin know what it meant? The jury in the end, when they convicted Yasin Aref on only part of the indictment, they could come to agreement that after a certain date, some months and months into the sting, did he finally become fully aware of the word Chaudhry. And I recall that this juror made reference to Yasin understanding that word prior to that date. And I stopped him and I said, wait a minute, but that's not what your verdict means. You said that he didn't understand the word Chaudhry before the date, whatever it was. And the juror's response was that, well, wait a minute, you don't think that Yasin Aref and the pizza guy, Muhammad Hussein, had conversations, private conversations about this? And I said, well, you can't do that. You can't assume evidence that's not offered at trial. You can't make any assumptions on the evidence. And they had made those assumptions. At least this juror did.
The terrorist plot in this case is one that the government's agent, a cooperating witness, represented to be underway. It was not real. It was represented.
The terrorist organizations send people to countries in advance to lay the groundwork. They have a vast network of people that they trust who can carry out whatever part of the operation is necessary at whatever time they're asked to do that. Our job is to figure out who all of these people are in the United States and prevent that from happening.
Are you claiming Aref was one of those people or not?
I would say that there is a concern that he was one of those people based on all the evidence that was uncovered in Iraq and all the additional evidence that was uncovered subsequently, and that the sting preempted anything that might have happened later on.
Also at the February 12, 2004 meeting, Malik met with Mohammed Hossein and Yassin Aref at Aref's house. According to the original indictment, this was the meeting where the recording device had fallen off Malik, and the conversation was from FBI agent Tim Cole's recollection. CI1 then said, "Something big is going to happen to teach the Pakistani consulate a lesson on 1 and 44, referring to 44th Street and 1st Avenue, New York, an address which fronts on the United Nations headquarters. The Pakistani government protested to the United States that the creation of a fictitious plot to kill the Pakistani UN ambassador was mind-boggling and a dangerous mission." Counts 20 through 27 charged that the men believed they were supporting a designated foreign terrorist organization.
Many people date the kind of response after 9/11 to the Patriot Act, but in fact, there was a real precursor to the Patriot Act, and that is the 1996 Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act. That law was passed with President Clinton's blessing by Congress about a year after the bombing of the Oklahoma City Federal Building. And in that law, Congress authorized the deportation of alien terrorists using secret evidence. It authorized punishing people criminally for what's called material support to designated terrorist organizations. That law, however, was almost unenforced until 9/11. Since 9/11, it has been the government's favorite vehicle for prosecuting people in quote-unquote terrorist cases, because in order to get a conviction under this statute, you don't have to prove that an individual engaged in any terrorist activity, that an individual conspired to engage in any terrorist activity, that an individual ever intended to support any terrorist activity. All you have to show is that an individual did something to support some group that we put on a blacklist. But the basic point is that we have revived the kind of McCarthy era tactic of creating a blacklist of proscribed groups in secret, in the executive branch, without any process. You know, when 9/11 happened, all of this sort of went on steroids, and you had law enforcement, as I say, going up and rounding up literally 5,000 men because for little more of the reason the fact that they were Arab Muslim males.
The terrorist network that struck America on September the 11th wants to strike our country again.
The executive branch has been secretly spying on large numbers of Americans for the last 4 years.
To stop them, our intelligence professionals need the best possible information about who the terrorists are, where they are, and what they are planning.
It's not enough to go after people who have committed crimes. We have to go after people who haven't committed crimes, because you want to prevent the next terrorist attack from occurring. So how do you go after people who haven't committed crimes? Well, you focus on people who fit the stereotypes, who fit the profile. And then you send informants into their groups. Then you lay out entrapment schemes. Then you enforce immigration laws against them harshly.
We interrupt this program with a special bulletin. America is now under martial law.
Osama Awadallah, a 21-year-old Jordanian college student from San Diego, arrested in 2001. He was not charged with any crime and was initially held as a material witness and beaten in the Manhattan Detention Center.
As a recent National Intelligence Estimate reported, America is in a heightened threat environment.
All constitutional rights have been suspended. Stay in your homes. Do not attempt...
Dr. Rafil Dafir, an oncologist born in Iraq and living in the United States for almost 30 years, was sentenced to 22 years in prison for violating the Iraqi sanctions by sending money to Iraq through his charity, Help the Needy.
The president claims that he can imprison any American citizen he chooses indefinitely for the rest of his life without even an arrest warrant, without notifying them of what charges have been filed against them.
Jose Padilla is a United States citizen who was arrested and detained as a material witness until President Bush designated him an illegal enemy combatant and transferred him to a military prison where he was held for 3 years. Bush argued that he was not entitled to trial in civilian courts.
Anyone caught outside the gates of their subdivision sectors after curfew will be shot. Remain calm. Do not panic.
James Yee. Army Captain James Yee was accused of espionage. After his arrest, Yee was blindfolded, placed in manacles, and taken to a Navy brig where he spent 76 days in solitary confinement.
5 years after the 9/11 attacks, some people in Washington still do not understand the nature of the enemy. So we will remain on the offense until the terrorists are defeated.
Dr. Sami Al-Aryan is a Palestinian computer engineer convicted of conspiracy to help Palestinian Islamic Jihad. Yet the New York Times holds out the possibility that Al-Aryan is, quote, nothing more sinister than an outspoken Palestinian activist suffering the wrath of a vengeful Department of Justice.
The President of the United States has been breaking the law repeatedly and insistently.
Cameras and surveillance equipment will be posted on all lampposts and streetlights.
Six Muslim imams were removed from a U.S. airliner and questioned by police for several hours before being released, the leader of the group said. They took us off the plane, humiliated us in a very disrespectful way. If up to now they don't know about prayers, this is a real problem, he said.
If the president has the inherent authority to eavesdrop on American citizens without a warrant, imprison American citizens on his own declaration, kidnap and torture, then what can't he do?
Syed Fahad Hashmi, a 26-year-old American citizen of Pakistani descent, arrested for his suspected role in aiding an al-Qaeda plot to attack targets in London. In 2007, he was extradited to the United States. He has been held in solitary confinement with no trial.
It is imperative that respect for the rule of law be restored in our country.
Manchester Umist students Sohail Ashraf and Kuram Zeb, two Muslim students thrown off a plane because other passengers feared they were suicide bombers. Just because we're Muslim does not mean we are suicide bombers.
For we are deeply in need of a new way beyond the darkness that seems so close around us.
From the criminal complaint, during the January 14, 2004 meeting, CI1 also told Aref that CI1 was working with Jaish-e-Mohammed, an Islamic extremist group based in Pakistan that is on the State Department's list of designated foreign terrorist organizations.
Malik launched into a description, I guess, of Jaish-e-Mohammed, J-E-M, and described how he was working for J-E-M to try to liberate Kashmir.
The following is from an audio recording made on January 14, 2004, while Malik and Yasin Aref were at a Dunkin' Donuts shop.
And one of the groups that I'm working with is Jaish-e-Mohammed, J-E-M, Maulana Azhar Mohammed.
That in the India?
Yeah. You know him? What kind of group?
I hear in the TV about him.
Okay.
The government agent consistently mispronounced the word missile as misail.
That's why the missiles that we send it to New York City to teach President Musharraf the lesson to not fight with us.
Here you have an organization, JEM, that is trying to liberate Kashmir from India. This has nothing to do with Yasin. Yasin is a Kurd. He's not trying to liberate Kashmir from India.
On February 3, 2004, Malik also spoke to Mohammad Hossein about the group he called JEM.
When Malik told him the organization that he claimed he worked for, he identified it as an organization called JEM. And when he described that to him, Mohammad Hossein indicated he knew what that was. It was a musical group, and he believed that Malik was associated with some form of a musical group.
From February 3, 2004 meeting between Malik and Mohammad Hossein, from the government's translation of Urdu. Malik, have you heard the name of Jaish-e-Mohammed, the organization? Hossein, Jaish-e-Mohammed. Malik, of Hazar Mahmud? Hossein, yes. Malik, have you heard of it? Hossein, yes, that Kawali. Jaish-e-Mohammed. Qawwali is a form of Sufi devotional music that has gained mainstream popularity in Bangladesh and India.
And the government agreed with that, that Hossein did not know who they were. And all Malik said to Hossein, to Mohammad Hossein, was that they help us, we do work in Kashmir. And that was his argument. The government brought in an expert witness, a fellow named Coleman, who supposedly was an expert in Middle Eastern organizations in Bangladesh. That's how he was advertised. That's how he was presented by the government. When he walked into the courtroom, and he's here to testify about Bangladesh political organizations as an expert, he couldn't name the Prime Minister of Bangladesh, the ruling party of Bangladesh, the political parties in Bangladesh, or the principles of the party about which he was to testify. He knew nothing. And in any other case, he would never have been allowed to testify, ever. In this case, because of what was involved and because of the times, he was allowed to testify. The expert Coleman did research online, on the internet, of an organization known as JEI, which is based throughout the Middle East. It's a different organization in Bangladesh, which is where Mohammad Hossein is from. In Bangladesh, it's a mainstream political party. Doesn't advocate violence, isn't involved in any illegal activity, is a trading partner with the United States and Bangladesh. We recognize them as a trading partner. He didn't realize that. And the day before his testimony, he came to realize that because we questioned him and pointed that out to him. So the night before he testified, he went online like any 12th grader would, and Googled the organization, and then walked in the next day and presented himself as an expert, doing no more than a Google search. And the Google materials that he got back were inaccurate, they were wrong.
You asked the judge to throw out Coleman's testimony, right?
I asked the judge to throw out Coleman's testimony three times. Before he testified, we had questioned Coleman under oath. And we had said, based upon how he testified before he appeared in front of the jury, he shouldn't be allowed to appear because he didn't know anything about JI or JEI. When the government then called him as a witness and questioned him, we made the same application and said, now he had said it in open court, we said, it's obvious he doesn't know anything about this organization. And then after the trial, we made a motion to the judge to throw out his testimony.
And what happened?
Well, Coleman's testimony stood and was a principal basis for our appeal. One of the bases. Should never have been allowed to testify. He didn't know what he was talking about. It's no more simple than that.
In 2006, after a six-week trial based on the initial charges, Mohammad Hossein was convicted of all 27 counts. Ultimately, Yassin was acquitted of 20 of the 30 original counts and was only convicted of charges stemming from the last two meeting dates after the June 10th meeting and one of the false statement counts. These convictions apparently originated from the jury's belief that by the June 10th meeting, Yassin understood the meaning of the code word Chaudhry.
The FBI invested a lot of time and energy and money into an elaborate sting operation. They were going to pursue it simply out of the force of what they've already done. One thing promotes the next.
After 9/11, the world changed dramatically, and law enforcement has a new responsibility, which I think we all expect, and that's to prevent the next one. And that's what this case is about. And that's what this case, you know, really exemplifies: the FBI, the Joint Terrorism Task Force, doing their job appropriately. When they have information about a particular individual that indicates to them that they may be a threat, you need to do something to find out. And they did their job. They found out.
In 2005, the Justice Department published a report on the history of the FBI's compliance with the Attorney General's guidelines. The report gave an historical view of FBI abuses in terms of intelligence gathering and the use of informants. In the 1950s, the FBI developed covert programs designed to collect intelligence about the communist influence in the United States. In the 1960s, a program called COINTELPRO investigated the civil rights, anti-war, and women's movements. In 1975, the Church Committee, after the exposure of the Nixon break-in of Watergate, determined that FBI headquarters alone had developed over 500,000 intelligence files on Americans and domestic groups. In 1981, the FBI opened a criminal investigation of the Committee in Solidarity with the People of El Salvador, or CSPACE, a United States-based group that opposed the Reagan administration's policies in Central America. In the wake of the CSPACE disclosures, the General Accounting Office reviewed the FBI's international terrorism program. They found that the FBI closed approximately 67% of its investigations because it did not develop evidence indicating international terrorist activities. Mosques were among the religious institutions targeted in the 1980s investigations.
I think that there was pressure to convict rather than pressure to indict. It was set up with counterterrorism task forces that were infused with incredible resources, agents, local police, state police, the best intelligence gathering, and then giving marching orders to go find the terrorists among us or those who would support terrorism. The pressure to convict for the Northern District was intensive. I think that it became an issue that we better not lose this case because we're losing some other cases around the country and we're starting to look bad.
If these individuals had come into contact with the appropriate, you know, terrorists or people with the bent to do that in this country today, we'd have had a missile attack in New York City. There's no question about that. They assisted in that and they participated in that. Now, what would you have us do? Sit on our hands?
At the press conference at the Federal Building in Albany after the sentencing, the FBI presented the reasons why they had targeted Yasin Arif. Based on notebooks found in random locations by U.S. military in northern Iraq between 2001 and 2003, associations with men classified as known terrorists and his own writings, the FBI and the Justice Department believed that there was reason to assume that he was sympathetic to terrorists and their causes.
With the information that the FBI had about this individual, the information coming from terrorist camps in Iraq.
FBI reason number one: Arif's name and Albany telephone number were found when our troops raided two different Ansar al-Islam camps and a safe house in Iraq during 2003.
What do you do when you have information that comes from a phone number or a name from a camp over in Iraq? What do you do with that? Do you just put it in your desk drawer and go home? Or do you think about it and try to figure out what to do? Do you go interview the people? Do you go do surveillance? Do you do whatever type of investigative technique you do? Whatever it is, it's vetted, it's thought all the way up through the chain of command, and we proceed forward understanding that we have a heavy responsibility to pursue it with all aggressiveness.
And there were press briefings routinely throughout the Iraq conflict, the Iraq war. And I did find the actual minutes, I think, from those press briefings on that particular raid. They, of course, billed it as a terrorist camp because any group of armed bandits who were roaming the countryside without any kind of clear-cut military allegiance, I think, were viewed as, potential terrorists. That's how they were labeled. What struck me was that you had no idea who these people were, whether any of them were hostages, how they got Yassin Aref's name in their notebook or address book. We don't even know whose side they were fighting on. I mean, it's never proven to me or in court if they were fighting against the Iraqis, against the U.S. forces. And since their camp was obliterated, I think, by missile fire, a lot of the proof went up in smoke. I don't think it's fair to say definitively that was a terrorist encampment. They never proved that at trial that I could recall.
The only thing that we were able to see was Xerox copies of what was supposedly found, where everything was blacked out except for Yassin's name and incomplete old address and phone number. We would have loved to contest it at trial, but it's all classified. We can't ask any questions about it.
FBI reason number two. An October 1999 letter from the Islamic Center in Erbil, Iraq, found during the Dafir investigation, introduced Aref as our representative and stated that he should receive your support. Agent Cole explained this reason, saying, "We were investigating at the time a person by the name of Rafael Dafir. During that investigation, we found a letter in the garbage because we searched his garbage, his trash. They call it a dumpster dive. And it said, Yassin Aref is our loyal representative. We expect cooperation from you all. And that was on IMK letterhead. We believe that the Islamic Central of Kurdistan is under the umbrella of the IMK.
Well, they allegedly found a piece of paper that says that Yassin was our representative from some group, which is not a terrorist group, some group called Islamic Central or Central in Erbil, which is in Kurdistan in Iraq.
As of October 11, 2005, the United States Department of State list of foreign terrorist organizations did not include the Islamic Central of Kurdistan or the IMK as a foreign terrorist organization. FBI reason number three. From October of 1999 until October of 2001, there were 14 telephone calls from Aref's Albany telephone to a telephone number in Damascus, Syria, which had been provided to an informant as a contact number for Al-Qaeda.
Jim, is it the case here that this sting operation was only mounted after extensive electronic surveillance of these gentlemen failed to yield any indictable offenses?
I can't answer that. Yeah.
In an article published in the New York Times in December 2005, Eric Lichtblau exposed the National Security Agency's warrantless wiretapping program. In February 2006, the defense attorneys submitted documents that declared that information about Yassin Aref had been acquired from this program.
What this program did was to circumvent the court and say that the NSA, on its own authority, if it thought that someone was a terrorist, was connected to Al-Qaeda, it could wiretap that person on its own. And I should say that this was limited to an American's international communications. This was either phone calls or emails coming to or from the United States to overseas involving Americans.
We filed what's called a Brady motion relating to those 14 calls because Yassin said if they know what was in those calls, if they recorded them, then they would know that these calls are totally innocent. I wasn't calling about politics. I was calling to talk to my friends and get news from Kurdistan. And they never said they don't have them. They just said that information is classified, and they denied the motion based on that. And you're not supposed to deny Brady motions based on classified information.
If the government wants to bring in secret evidence into court, well, the courts can use certain measures to make sure that it doesn't become public, but the other side's defense attorneys have to have a chance to see it and to challenge it. Now, the defense lawyers understandably wanted to find out about this surveillance. They made some motions to the court to try to find out what happened. The government responded to those motions with a brief that was essentially fully classified, and then a few hours later, the judge came out with an opinion that the judge claimed was also fully classified. And that is sort of an unprecedented thing in American law. The judicial branch doesn't have the power to classify documents. They have the power to redact and place things under seal, but classification has always been thought to be sort of a presidential power.
FBI reason number four. RF was a known associate of John Earl Johnson and other individuals with known terrorist sympathies. FBI agent Cole said, Johnny Johnson lived in the apartment that abuts the mosque. His back door comes out behind the mosque, almost right next to the mosque door, but he's a very close associate of Yassin. He's a member of the mosque. It's our position that he actually knew him very well, that even Johnny Johnson had used Yassin Aref's car, and I personally seen him drive Yassin Aref's car. The fifth reason that the FBI claims is proof of Yassin's guilt is an excerpt from a poem Yassin wrote in 1999.
Raise the jihad sword, raise the Quran with blood, so we can bring back freedom for ourselves and the entire peoples of the earth.
Jihad in itself is striving for the better, so there is no violence in it. Because here I am between two forces. One force that is pulling me down, yani forcing me to do bad deed, and another force that wants me to do a good deed. And I am in between, struggling in between, which way to go. So there is no violence in it. And usually it is to better oneself. So there is no violence in that concept.
And this is the meaning of jihad. It has nothing to do with holy war. Holy war means harb muqaddasa. Or fighting means qital. So the knowledge of the Arabic language is very crucial. Otherwise, please don't pass your judgment. It's not fair.
Brother Yassin arrived in this community from Syria. He was a refugee from Kurdistan, the northern portion of Iraq.
Between his conviction on October 10, 2006, and his sentencing on March 8, 2007, 5 months later, Yassin Aref wrote the entire manuscript of Son of Mountains in the Rensselaer County Jail in Troy, New York. He wrote it in longhand on yellow legal pads and finished it the day before his sentencing. Son of Mountains was published on March 10, 2008, almost a year to the day after Yassin finished writing it.
I was born in 1970 in the Kurdish village of Hashazini in the Garmain region of Kurdistan in Iraq. In early 1989, the government's army came and completely destroyed Hashazini as part of the Anval campaign of genocide against the Kurds. Our family fled before the army arrived, so we survived. But we lost our home and farm. Altogether, some 1,200 villages were destroyed, and over 180,000 innocent people were murdered. These mass graves are now being uncovered, and the truth is finally being discovered by the world. But the sad truth is that when hundreds of thousands of Kurds were being killed during the Anfal campaign, the world was silent.
One church in colony sponsored Brother Yassin, his family, his three children at that time, and brought him here in Albany.
When Yassin first arrived in Albany, he spoke almost no English and worked as a janitor at the Albany Medical Center. He was then offered a position as part-time imam at the Masjid As-Salam Mosque. As his English improved, he was offered the position full-time.
I'm a young Muslim. I was born and raised Muslim, and I've been around many Islamic leaders. And for some reason, Yassin just had this character that was very, very beautiful, and I couldn't get away from it. Very beautiful. Very patient. Very soft-spoken. Made the religion very easy for everyone. And that's why I'm so attracted to him, and this is one of the reasons why I came back to Albany after him being sentenced, because of his children, the situation that they're in. And I said, I'm going to Albany just to aid his family. Just it. Because he affected me so much in my life in the 7 years that I knew him. And many people, they have the same story. But for me and my relationship with him, It was almost like a father relationship. And I have a father. And I love Yassin very much, and I don't think it'll never end. He's the greatest person I've ever met, and he practices what he preaches. Self-centered? Nowhere near self-centered. Living is all for other people. Wanting to build other people or make other people happy. Who can I fall in love with somebody like this? So people ask me, why you do this, why you do that?
Excuse me.
I will never stop doing what I'm doing. Not for somebody like him. Never. Very tough situation. It's a very tough situation, but as a Muslim, we understand the struggle is always going to be here. It happened to better people before. This is the nature. We all know from our history, the good people, they have very difficult lives. Either they get killed or they get put in jail. The struggle still goes on. Can't stop.
Judge McEvoy issued his targeting instruction to the jury after prosecutors and defense attorneys argued privately about how much the jury should know about why agents zeroed in on Yassin Aref.
Well, why do you think the jury was already predisposed? Because of comments that the judge made at the opening day of trial?
Look at this targeting instruction. That reversed the burden of proof, and so that was an error, and that means we have to have a new trial, because the judge is not supposed to tell the jury that there were good reasons for going after this guy. The first time the judge gave the targeting instruction was at the end of the trial, but before the closings by the lawyers.
The court. There really isn't a question in this case as to the reason Mr. Aref was targeted by the FBI for these questions he was asked. The reasons were good and valid reasons based on suspicions that the FBI had.
He did it again after the closings by the lawyers.
The court. The FBI had certain suspicions, good and valid suspicions, for looking into Mr. Aref, but why they did is not to be a concern of yours.
So he did it twice, and the prosecutor did it in his closing, too.
The prosecutor. Ladies and gentlemen, Judge McEvoy told you that the FBI had good and valid reasons for conducting this investigation, and the government would not be permitted to put on its reasons because that is not an issue you are called on to decide.
And the prosecutor not only said there were good reasons for going after Yassin, but said there was evidence that we weren't allowed to present. So the jury's told directly, there's evidence against this guy that you weren't allowed to see, and that's extremely prejudicial.
In Iraq, you cannot trust whether or not a stranger was an informant. In America, it is the same. Even in the mosque, you cannot trust anyone because you did not know who was scanning a tape recorder. In Iraq, they could jail you without evidence. In America, they will jail you based on secret evidence they say is classified. In Iraq, they told the imams that they were not allowed to preach on certain topics. In America, they say that everyone is free to speak. But when you criticize the government, you are accused of being anti-American and anti-Semitic. In Iraq, there is no mail service and no international calls. In America, there is mail and phone service. But the FBI will open your mail and wiretap your telephone. So feel free to write and say whatever you want. But be 100% sure that the FBI will read what you write, listen to what you say, and will arrest you if you are too truthful in criticizing the government.
I
I met Yassin in 1999. I met his wife, Zuhur, first as a UN refugee. You know, there's a very small community of Iraqis in here. And then the next thing I hear, I was in Virginia, actually, the arrest of two terrorists. And here is Yassin on national television.
I don't think I ever thought that they were guilty. I can't imagine that two men who put this much energy into living full lives would want to be terrorists. These were people that were completely innocent of anything. They cut the families off completely from any source of anything. They cut them off from any financial help. They cut them off from everything. And they were just left.
Then Kathy took it upon herself to be a partner with me on this. I said to her, I can't do this on my own.
We decided to call for a town meeting. We needed to do something, and we needed to do it quickly. We had a room that probably could hold 30 people, and there were at least 50 people in that room that night. There were probably 10 or 15 Muslims in that room. The community was really mad, and this was proof. The community was furious. From that meeting that night, we evolved into the Muslim Solidarity Committee. It was through the winter that we had anywhere from 10 people to 40 or 50 out in front of the courthouse. We also set up committees for the families, one for the Hossein family, one for the Arab family, and just to make sure that they were supported and that the kids were supported. The kids knew that there were people out there. It was really important to a lot of people that the children knew that there were non-Muslims who were trying to help them. That was the most important thing, because a lot of the committee thought, you know, 10 children of Muslim families who are going to think that every non-Muslim person in the United States hates them. I think a lot of us thought, well, where's the Muslim community? Why aren't they out here helping? But then slowly we started to realize and understand they were afraid to come to the vigils because they got followed home by the police. They were afraid to come to any of our meetings because they knew that there would be people in those meetings that represented the FBI. They were terrified. We learned that almost every family that attended the mosque, the Central Avenue Mosque, had been interviewed by the FBI. Some families had been raided. They were just so afraid.
So we got a petition together, and then it was just as many people as could carry a petition.
From the trial sentencing document, March 8th, 2007, the court. I've received petitions. I've received many, many letters on behalf of your client. Some, a couple of them, not so complimentary, but the vast majority of them said a lot of nice things about him. And the court will certainly take that into consideration.
And we were very successful. I remember we wanted to get 1,000 signatures, and we got very close to 1,000 signatures. I thought maybe 200. The lawyers thought maybe 250. We were astonished.
There was a 5-month delay from the handing down of the verdicts to the sentencing of Aref and Hossein.
The final petitions are all delivered. The petitions only began to circulate on December 10th. So in just under 3 months, we got between 875 and 900 individual signatures. So I think that is pretty good. And that's a way to gauge community support for these men and community extreme discomfort with the verdict and all that has happened.
Thank you.
and a card for Yasin.
Okay.
On March 24, 2008, lawyers for the defense presented their oral arguments in the Second Circuit Court of Appeals in New York City.
They've got top prosecutors on this case. They've got the Justice Department. They've got unlimited resources, and they've got some of the best lawyers in New York State working on their case. So we know what we're up against, and we hope we met that challenge.
You know, I'm cautiously optimistic, I guess you could say, but realistically, it's a long shot for an appeals court to overturn a jury verdict. Just hearing the key words, Muslim terrorism, I think that's going to be, that's like nine strikes. I'm afraid that's nine strikes to begin with. So I'm sorry to say, I think this is really a long shot.